the Lord says, oh, give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. For his mercy endures forever. Let the redeemed, that's you, let the redeemed of the Lord say so, whom he has redeemed from the hand of the enemy. Verse 4, they wandered in the wilderness in a desolate way. They found no city to dwell in. Hungry and thirsty, their soul fainted in them. Then they cried out to the Lord in their trouble, and he delivered them out of their distress. Verse 10, those who sat in darkness and in the shadow of death, bound in affliction and irons, because they rebelled against the word of God and despised the counsel of the Most High. Therefore, he brought down their heart with labor. They fell down, and there was none to help. Then they cried out to the Lord in their trouble, and he saved them out of their distress. I'm going to be speaking on the topic, my God can deliver, and my God can save. My God can deliver, and my God can save. In this text, the writer begins with acknowledging his incompetence and realizing that if it had not been for God's mercy, he would be lost, he could be depressed, he could be homeless, he could be in a jail cell, and for some of us, we could be dead. But because of the mercy of God, we are not consumed. And because we serve a king who breathes the breath of kindness and the breath of forgiveness, we are here. It is because of the mercy of God that I am standing before you. It is not through my words. It is not through what I have. It is not through my gifts. It is not through my skill. But it is because of the mercy of God that I stand before you. Hallelujah. If I was living a long time ago, I would have died if I cursed. I would have died if I sinned. But because of the mercy of God, we are not consumed. The writer here begins with confessing his incompetence by acknowledging God's mercy. Some of us here today, all we need to do is just confess that we are powerless, that we are incompetent, and that we are sufficient. But because of God's mercy, we are not consumed. And I've come to tell you today that your deliverance and your salvation begins with your confession. Your deliverance and your salvation begins with your acknowledgement. Hallelujah. Romans 10, chapter 9, to chapter 10, verse 9 says, if you openly declare that Jesus is Lord, and if you believe in your heart, hallelujah, that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. Once you realize that God is the only reason why you are here, and he's the only reason why you're still breathing, and it is his mercy that has kept you, hallelujah, at that moment you will be delivered, and that moment you will be saved. I know a lot of us young people, we don't have the stories of our elders, we don't have the stories of our grandparents, but we do have the story that I am here today, and I've come to tell you that you are only breathing because of the mercy of God. You are only sitting, hallelujah. You are only standing because of the mercy of God. Hallelujah. It is because of his mercy that we are not consumed. It is because of his mercy that I have a heart to love. It is because of his mercy that I have a soul. Hallelujah. It is because of his mercy that I have a renewed mind. It is because of the mercy of God. Lamentations chapter 3, verse 22 and 23 says, through the Lord's mercies, we are not consumed, but because his compassions fail not. Hallelujah. They are new every morning. Great is your faithfulness. Hallelujah. I've come to tell you, every morning you wake up, you ought to thank him for his mercy. For every new mercy that's made every morning, there ought to be a new acknowledgement. For every new mercy that you experience, there ought to be a new confession. Every morning you wake up, you ought to thank God for his mercy, because his mercy endures forever. Somebody say forever. Somebody say forever. So despite
despite what I do, and despite how I fall, and despite how I sin, this is not an encouragement to fail God, but despite what I do, it is the mercy of God that gives me forgiveness. The mercy of God allows me to lust and He still loves me. The mercy of God allows me to love and He still loves me. The mercy of God allows me to sin and God is still there for me. It is the mercy of God why I'm not consumed. Somebody say forever. And it goes forever. So here the writer is speaking of the mercy of God. This psalm is prayed after the writer knows what it is to sin against God and still be delivered. This comes from our reading after David prayed and begged God, hallelujah, please do not cast me away from your presence and do not take your Holy Spirit from me. We read this psalm after we read Psalms 51. And I've come to tell you that God can deliver you from the state of begging. Hallelujah. You don't have to beg anymore. You don't have to beg for His mercy. You don't have to beg for His grace. You don't have to beg for His love, because His mercy endures. It is the mercy of God that delivers me from the state of begging. And I am here today because I don't have to beg. Because if I had to beg, I wouldn't be standing here. But because of the Lord's mercy, and because He loves on me every morning, and because I wake up in mercy, I wake up bathed in mercy. We wake up bathed in love. We wake up bathed in grace. We wake up bathed in mercy. And it's because of that that we are still here. Hallelujah. You ought to be grateful. I don't know what stories and where you've come from and what you've done and who you've hurt and who you've disappointed and who you've killed and how you've sinned. But it is the mercy of God while you are still here. So the writer now speaks from a place of assurance and begins to explain to us the capacity of God's mercy. In verses 4 through 13, the writer makes an obvious distinction between two types of sinners who have sinned against God. And I want you to pay attention very clearly. There's a distinction between two types of sinners who have experienced the mercy of God. In verse 4, it says, they wandered, hallelujah, in the wilderness in a desolate way. They wandered in the wilderness in a desolate way. In verse 4, the first sinner is a wanderer. The wanderer is one who knows the right way, knows God's way, know what God has called him to do, know the anointing that God has placed in him, know the calling on his life, but decides, I'm going to take a detour to roam aimlessly according to my will. That is the wanderer. The wanderer might have gotten bored with church. He might have, hallelujah, fell off a bit with God and begin to wander. Hallelujah. You might have gotten hurt in church. You might have gotten disappointed. Hallelujah. You might have gotten your feelings hurt, and because of this you began to wander. Hallelujah. God said that many of you have become wandering Christians. You know my voice, you know my purpose for you, you know my heart, but you wandered. Hallelujah. Because the journey has gotten a little uncomfortable, because you faced a trial, and because you faced a bump in the road, because you faced a hurdle, you began to wander. Hallelujah. In verse 4 it says, they found no city to dwell in. Like the wanderer, you found no hope outside of God. In your journey, many of you, hallelujah, realize that when you wander, that God is the only way, He is the only truth, and the only light. While you wander, many of you can admit that I was bored outside of God, even though it temporarily felt good, and I had my emotions satisfied for a moment. I eventually got weary. I eventually, hallelujah, and in verse 5 it says, hungry and thirsty, their soul fainted in them. So while they wandered, they found no city to dwell in. And because of this, they're hungry and thirsty. And after that, their soul fainted within them. The wanderer got weary. While wandering, many of you can admit that you got tired. While you were wandering and searching for another source and searching for another God and searching for another piece of happiness and searching for another love and searching for another joy, many of you can admit that you got tired. You got tired of chasing everything else but God. You got tired of being hurt. You got tired of being disappointed. You got tired of being left down. Even though before you did it, you were like, I'm going to get out of here. But when you got there, you realized that I don't have Jesus, so I have nothing. You wandered, but you got tired, and you got weary, and you got disappointed, and you were let down, and your heart was broken, and you fell, and you couldn't get up. And then when you were on the floor, you realized that it's only Jesus that can pick me up. But look at verse 6. Look at verse 6. It says, then they cried out to the Lord in their trouble. And he delivered them, and he picked them up out of their distress. I've come to tell you this morning, and this is the sole purpose of the message, hallelujah. There is deliverance, hallelujah, for the wanderer. If you gave up, if you gave in, if you took a detour, if you were curious, and God was calling you this way, but you went that way, there is still deliverance for you. There is still deliverance, there is still healing, there is still joy, there is still peace, there is still happiness, there is still kindness, there is still gentleness, there is still self-control, there is still Jesus for you. God will save you. Somebody say, my God can deliver. Somebody say, my God can save. Raise your hand if you need it and if you're happy about it. My God can deliver and my God can save. So that's the first type of sinner, the wanderer. The wanderer gave up. The wanderer got distracted. The wanderer took a detour. It's not that the wanderer didn't love God. It's not that the wanderer wasn't concerned about God. It's not that the wanderer didn't think about God. But the wanderer got a little bored. The wanderer got hurt. The wanderer got curious. And instead of sticking to the right way, and instead of sticking to the narrow way, the wanderer took a detour. Keep that in mind. So the second sinner is the rebel. The first sinner is the wanderer. Now the second type of sinner is the rebel. In verse 10, it shows us, it says, I'm going to read it again. Those who sat in darkness and in the shadow of death, bound in affliction and irons, because they rebelled against the words of God and despised the counsel of the Most High. So that's a distinguishment from the first type of sinner we've seen. The rebel is the one who sat in darkness, who bathed in darkness, who bathed in the enemy, who bathed in the will of the enemy, and in the shadow of death. The rebel got totally distracted. It's not just a little bit of distracted now, but the rebel got totally distracted, hallelujah, and decided to do things his way instead of God's way. He decided that I'm going to satisfy myself and I'm going to neglect God. The rebel is bound. Because of this, the rebel is now bound in affliction. He has no more happiness. He has no more joy. He has no more peace. He has no more kindness. He has no more gentleness. He has no more self-control because he is bound in affliction. I just want you to be honest and transparent in the house of God and raise your hand if you ever felt bound in affliction. If you ever found yourself bound and tied down and captive and you felt like there was nothing else.